Stanford University.
Okay, well, welcome to Stanford TS193P, spring of 2016. This is our last normal lecture. The only lecture we have left is our alternate final next week. Today we are going to have a demo of all the stuff I talked about on Monday. So mostly that's segues, including modal segue, popover segue, unwind segue, and even we'll talk about the adaptive presentation, how we adapt to horizontally compact, all that stuff. I'm going to throw a little bit of bonus in there. We'll talk a little bit about visual effects like blur. You'll see a lot of blur in the UI occasionally, and I'll show you how to basically do that. Now, I think that's going to take most of the time, but if I have any time left, like maybe 5 or 10 minutes left, I'll try to do a quick tour through persistence, because creating files in the file system, stuff like that, is something a lot of people are going to want to do in their final project, so I'll try and cover that. No demo for that, unfortunately, but at least maybe I can get through the slides if the demo goes on a good pace. Okay, so here's our demo. Those are all the things we're going to cover. So it's quite a quick demo, involved demo. It's going to be an extension of tracks, okay, the thing that we left off with last time. I'll run that really quick just to remind yourself in the last 2 days what it did. So remember that it went out on the internet, it grabbed a GPX file, which is just basically a file that contains a bunch of waypoints and possibly hyperlinks attached to the waypoints, and puts them on the map here so we can scroll around and zoom in and out on them. And we made it so that if we clicked on them, the callout had a left accessory callout view right here, this left accessory callout view, and put a thumbnail that it found in the GPX file for each waypoint. Okay? So now what we're going to do today, the next thing we're going to do is learn how to segue from a map, because it's a little unusual trying to segue from a map, because when you look at it in the storyboard, it's just blank. There's a big blank map view, so that you can't, it's not like a table view where you've got a row you can control drag from or something. So we're going to have to do this segueing from a map in code. And what we're going to do is make it so when we click on this little thumbnail button right here, it segues, okay, and puts an image view controller that will show you the full large image of this. And we're going to get the UI for doing that image view controller. We're just going to steal that right out of Cassini. And you're going to see the advantage of building these MVCs that have very clear public models. It makes them quite reusable. So we can reuse that MVC we made in Cassini with absolutely no changes. We're just going to drag it in and set up its public API, and it'll work perfectly. So let's go do that right now. Let's go over to Cassini. And where is Cassini? It's here in Developer, Cassini. Bring up this Cassini here. So remember, you'll remember Cassini here, and it's the one that showed the image of Cassini, what it was doing. So I'm just going to grab this image view controller right here, this class, image view controller, and I'm going to pick it up and drag it into my app over here, and I'm going to copy it in. Okay? But I can do actually more than that, more than just grabbing that MVC. I can actually go to the storyboard and find the place in the storyboard down here, actually, where Cassini is using the image view controller. And I can copy that scene from Cassini and then bring it on over to our storyboard here. We'll zoom out so you can see this. Okay, and we can paste. And that actually dropped an image view controller there with the scroll view already in it and wired up, and it has the proper identity, right, image view controller. So it's all really nice. So don't forget that in storyboards. You can copy and paste scenes between storyboards, and it'll bring it all. And it brings it all by name, remember, so you have to have the classes with the same name or outlets with the same name for it all to work. Okay, so let's go ahead and build the rest of our UI that we have here. We want to segue from this map view over to this scroll view, but we don't really have anything to control drag from here because the callouts and things like that are all come up programmatically. So we're going to do a manual segue, which we've already seen. And the way we do that is we control drag from the view controller itself just to create a segue with a certain identifier, okay, between the two MVCs. So let's just get these both on screen here, and I'm going to control drag from here over to here. We're going to put this inside of a navigation controller, so this is going to be a show segue right here. And we'll give it a name. This is going to show an image, so we'll call this show image segue. Let's be sure to go ahead and embed this in a navigation controller. Okay, Oops. So let's zoom out and take a look at our UI. So here's our UI. We could even do some other things like here, like maybe this, we want to give it a title. We'll call it Tracks or something like that. And this title will set programmatically depending on which waypoint we're looking at. We'll put whatever the name of that waypoint is in at the top. So we'll do that in the code. All right. So how are we going to fire off this segue right here from the code? Where's a good place to do it in the code? Well, we know we want to do it when we click on that left accessory view button right there. And if you remember from lecture, there's a really cool map view, MK map view delegate method. I'm just back here in GPX view controller here. So there's a really cool map view delegate method that will get called when an accessory view is tapped on and that accessory view is a UI control, like a UI button, for example. All right, so let's put that in here. That thing is called callout accessory. There it is, map view, annotation view, callout accessory view tapped. Okay, give ourselves a lot more room here. This is this method. And all we need to do here is look at the control that was tapped and see if it's our left accessory view. Okay, so if the control equals our view's left callout accessory view, okay, then we know someone tapped on that left side, and we want to do this segue. And we know how to perform a segue from code. We just do perform segue with identifier. Okay, the identifier is that show image. I actually created a constant for that right here. Okay, just so my code would be nice. So constants.showImage segue. And what about the sender? Well, when this segue happens, we're going to need to know which of our many waypoints we want to show the image of. Okay, so we need to pass a sender on to prepare for segue that can identify it. And a simple thing to do here, okay, this argument that we get right here is the annotation view, okay, that this callout has a left accessory view for. So we'll just pass that along. So we'll just pass that as the sender, which makes sense. The annotation view is the sender. And from the annotation view, we're going to be able to get the waypoint that we want. Okay. So that couldn't be any simpler right there. Now what about the navigation? So let's put in some navigation here, the prepare for segue, because any segue needs to be prepared. In this case, we're going to have to prepare that image view controller with its public API, which if you'll remember is an image URL. We have to give it the URL of an image, okay? So prepare for segue, let's do that, prepare for segue. And what do we need to prepare for segue? First of all, let's collect some information here. Like, let's get the destination view controller. That's the segue's destination view controller. And actually, I'm going to do that content view controller trick that we did, where we have a little extension, content view controller here, a little extension to UI view controller, so that if the thing is in a navigation controller, we return the visible view controller. Otherwise, we just return self. You remember this from before. This is so that if we're in a split view and we happen to put the detail, for example, inside a navigation controller, we can get the thing that's inside. All right, so we'll do the content view controller here. So that's the destination of this segue. Let's get the annotation view, which is the sender. Okay, the sender entry object should be an annotation view. So let's go ahead and get that by saying the sender as an MK annotation view. Okay. Let's also get the waypoint that we're talking about here. Okay, all these segues are going to be segueing from something that has a waypoint. So what is that? That's going to be the annotation views annotation, and it has to be a GPX waypoint, which they all should be. All the annotations that we add to our map view implement the MK annotation protocol, and so they're all GPX waypoints, so this should always come out true. So we kind of got these little things that we need. So now let's just say if the segue identifier equals the constants show segue, show image segue, okay, so we know we're doing the show image, then if we can get an image view controller as the destination, so if the destination is an image view controller, then we can just load it up by saying its image URL equals the waypoint's image URL. Right? Remember image URL? We added that when we put this little extension on here that did the thumbnail URL. We also added the image URL. And it's just going to look in the GPX file information to find an image URL that's got the type large versus the type thumbnail. Okay? Because we obviously want to show the large image when we segue to it. Right? All right. So that's good. While we're here, let's go ahead and set the title of this thing to be the waypoint's name. So that'll give us a nice title at the top of our MVC. Okay, make sense? All right, so let's go ahead and run, see what this does, see if this works for us. All right, so here's all of our little waypoints here. So let's click on a waypoint, like this one. It's still working. Okay, we've got the picture in here. But now hopefully if we click on this, we'll segue. And sure enough, here we go. We've segued my image view controller. It's not quite as nice as the one you did in your homework in terms of the white space management, but it works. And notice it's got the title up here as well, the title of this thing, Panorama, got passed along there. Okay, so that was pretty easy. The next thing we're going to do is make it so that in our map here, we can add a waypoint. Now, this is a demo. I'm not going to go so far as to actually rewrite the GPX file to add this waypoint to it, but I'm going to show you how to at least add the waypoint to the map. Okay. Now, the UI I'm going to use here is long press. I don't know if you've seen a long press gesture, but it's basically if you just press with your finger and you hold it down long enough, it'll start looking like a long press. To iOS, and when you long press, I'm going to drop another pin there, a new pin. Okay, it's going to be a new waypoint. All right, so let's put that in our UI first. Let's go back here to our storyboard, and we're just going to add a long press gesture to this map. So I'm going to go over here, down to this. I'll even search for it, make it easier, long press. Here it is right here. So I'm going to add this long press. The map view is the one who's going to recognize it right there, so we'll add it to it. And now we'll go ahead and make this long press send its action to our view controller. So let's get them on the screen at the same time here. All right, go automatic. Okay, we'll put it, let's put it right down here. Okay, so I'm just going to control drag from the long press gesture into here. It's going to be an action. We'll call this add waypoint because that's what this gesture is going to do. It's going to add a waypoint. Okay, let's go ahead and go back here. All right, so we've got add waypoint right here. What do we need to do when we add a waypoint? Well, first we're going to do it as soon as we recognize the long press. So as soon as it starts recognizing this long press, we're going to do it. Now, a long press is actually a continuous gesture. If you hold the long press down, it'll keep firing. Okay, fire over and over and over. We don't want that. We don't want to add a whole bunch of waypoints. We just want the first one. So as soon as we recognize that it's a long press, we're going to drop the waypoint. We don't care what happens with the press after that. We're ignoring it. Okay? So we got to get the coordinate, okay, that CL coordinate 2D, right, the latitude and longitude of this thing that's dropped. And to do that, we're going to have to take the coordinate from the gesture, which is a view coordinate, and turn it into longitude and latitude. Well, luckily, MapView knows how to do that. MapView has a method called convert point to coordinate from view. You see it right there, the first one, convert point to coordinate from view. So the point it wants to convert is the gesture recognizer's location in view. Okay, and what view? The map view itself. So we're going to get the location of the gesture in the map view, and we're going to turn it into a coordinate, and the coordinate we're converting from is the map view also. Okay, so now we've got the latitude and longitude that the long press happened at. So now let's create a waypoint, and we're going to do that by just saying gpx.waypoint latitude and longitude, right? So the latitude is the coordinates latitude, and the longitude is the coordinates longitude, right? This coordinate right here, that's this coordinate we just created. All right, so we got a waypoint, and we can give the waypoint a name. Let's give it a default name. We'll call it dropped, since we just dropped this waypoint onto the map. Now let's go ahead and add that as an annotation to the map. And we know that this is legal for us to do, because add annotation takes an MK annotation, and we know that GPX waypoint implements the MK annotation protocol, so this is perfectly legal for us to do. Right? All right, so let's go take a look and see if this works. All right, so here we are. I'm just going to, let's say right up here, there's a little airport right here, so let's hold it down and drop, and sure enough, it dropped a pin there. Okay, we drop another one over here, another one over here. Now, if I click on this, I'm just going to get dropped. Okay, also, what if I put this in the wrong spot and I wanted to pick it up Okay, there's no way to pick it up and move it. And that's because these pins are not draggable. And if you remember from the slides, to make a pin draggable, you have to take that coordinate var. You know, we have this coordinate var that we added when we were implementing MK annotation. We added this. This has to be read and write to make these things, obviously, draggable. If they're going to be draggable, when they drop in the new place, we need to set the new coordinates. So we need to have a editable, or one of these that has a get and a set. So I'm actually going to do that by creating a subclass of GPX Waypoint called editable waypoint. Okay, it's just going to subclass gpx.waypoint. And in that subclass, I'm going to make coordinate be read write var. So coordinate CL location coordinate 2D is going to have a get, and it's also going to have a set. Now for the get, I'm just going to do super coordinate. Okay, and we should note that we are overriding this var from GPX waypoint. Okay, and for the set, we got this new value, which is a coordinate. I need to put that into the GPX's data structure, which is latitude and longitude, right? So I'm just going to say here that our latitude equals the new values latitude, and our longitude equals the new values longitude. Okay, so we're setting the latitude and the longitude in the GPX waypoint from this new coordinate value that we got. Okay, so we'll do that. Did you get that? You understand what I did there? So I have this new class now, editable waypoint. Yeah, I probably could have done that here, put in the extension, but it's actually nice, as you're going to see, to have a whole class that we know that this is an editable waypoint by looking at its class, actually. All right. Okay, so let's go back now to here. And instead of creating a GPX waypoint here now, when we add waypoint, I'm going to create an editable waypoint. Okay? So it can be moved around. Now the other thing I need to do to make it draggable is to go here to where I create my annotation, view for annotation, which remember is kind of like self-arrow and index path for a map view. Here's where I create the left callout accessory. I also need to say whether it's draggable. Okay, and that's just going to be whether or not the annotation that we passed on here is an editable waypoint. Okay, if the annotation is of class editable waypoint, then we know it's editable, and so it's draggable. See how giving that in a separate class was kind of cool? Makes our code read kind of nice there. All right, so we should be able to drag this around, so let's see if it works. All right, so we're going to drop one right here. Here it is. We can see this has dropped. Can we pick it up and drag it? Let's see. Yes, we can. All right, put it somewhere else. Pick it up again. Put it over here. Okay, so that's kind of cool. So now what are we going to do? Well, it's kind of annoying that this just says dropped. Okay, we don't want to say dropped. We want to actually edit it and see, you know, if I put it over here on top of this little airport right here, I probably want to put airport in there. Okay? And so how are we going to do that? Well, this is a good opportunity to show you a modal segue, okay? Because what we're going to do is we're going to create a little MVC to edit the name and the description there of the waypoint, and we're going to modally present that MVC, okay? So how are we going to do that? Pretty straightforward. Let's start here by figuring out how we're going to get that modal MVC to appear. And what I'm going to do is, you see how I'm using over here the left accessory view? Now I'm going to use the right accessory view on these, and I'm going to put a detailed disclosure button in there. That's the little blue, kind of looks like a blue round circle with a caret in it. So I'm going to put that kind of button in here. And only on editable waypoints will I put it there. And when you click on that, it's going to bring up this modal panel that lets you edit the name and info. Okay? So let's go ahead and do that. Let's change our UI to make our UI do that. So how are we going to do that? We're going to have to add a right callout accessory view, just like we added a left callout accessory view here. So I'm going to do the same thing where I clear it out first, because if it's not an editable waypoint, we don't want it in there. And remember, we're reusing these things, right? DQ reusable. So we have to clear it out from previous uses. And so here I'm just going to say if the waypoint is an editable waypoint, then I need to add this right callout accessory view, which is just going to be a UI button of type, what's it called, detailed disclosure. Okay, so I'm just going to put it on there. It's only going to appear on editable ones, which is exactly what we want. Now, how do we make it so that it's going to do this modal segue whenever we do it? We're going to do the exact same way that we did for the left callout accessory, which is we're going to do it in this callout accessory control tapped, okay? Because now this is the right side one. So I'm going to say else if the control equals the right callout accessory view, okay? Then I need to perform a segue, a different one. This one's going to be called, let's see what I called it down here in the constants. I called it edit waypoints, the edit user waypoint segue, right? Edit user waypoint. Okay, and the sender is still going to be the view because we still want to know which waypoint we're editing. Okay, and of course we'll have to fix our prepare for segue to do that as well. But let's take a timeout from doing our prepare for segue and go into our storyboard and add that new MVC. All right, so here we are. I'm going to make this a little zoomed out a little bit. So I'm going to put this new view controller just by dragging out an empty view controller onto the top up here. This is where we're going to put this thing. It's of course going to need its own custom class. So let's go file new, create a subclass of UI view controller. Okay, we'll call this our edit waypoint view controller because that's what it does. Edits a waypoint. We'll put it same place as everything as usual. Here it is. We'll go ahead and get rid of all this stuff. So that's clean. Let's go ahead and build the UI of it. Okay, what's the UI of this thing going to look like here? Well, it's going to be a pretty simple UI. It's going to have two fields, one for the name of the waypoint and one for like the info, right, the little description of the waypoint. So that's going to be easy to build. Let's just go down here and grab a text field or two. There's one text field. There's another one. Let's grab a couple labels, okay, for our name and description. Sorry, so this is the name of the waypoint. This is the description of it, which is called the info field in the GPX structure. So we'll right align these because they're going to be names. We'll go ahead and put these in a stack view here. So let's embed these in a stack view. Hopefully it'll figure it out it's horizontal. It does. We'll put a little spacing in there, maybe 8 or something like that. Same thing here. Let's put those in. Okay, also 8. Now let's put these in a vertical stack view. Okay, maybe we'll also do 8 here as well. Okay, now these aren't quite looking like what we want. This is in the center. We don't really want center alignment here. We'd like it to fill the entire space. Also, we'd really want this and this lined up, which really means we want name and description to be the same width. So I'm actually going to control drag between these two and make them be equal widths. Okay, make name and description be equal widths. And also, and it's going to take effect in a second here, I think. Let's also put it in position. We're going to put this leading edge. We're going to put this the top edge. We're going to put this to the trailing edge. And we're going to put this to the bottom edge. Okay? Now, where we put these is a little weird, okay? This one is our standard thing here where we want this to be 0 or standard value, so there's no standard value, so we'll make it 0. That makes it nice and wide. That's good. This one right here, I actually don't want this one to be 0 because I really want name and description to sit at the top. So you might argue, I don't even need a constraint on the bottom here. But here's the thing. When I put this on screen, okay, the size is going to change. I always want to make sure there's at least the standard issue thing from the bottom, okay, the standard space from the bottom. And you'll see why that is a little bit later. So I'm actually going to have the constant here be greater than or equal to the standard value. Okay, so just remember that I put a constraint on the bottom that makes sure it's greater than or equal to the standard value. We'll see that later. So, equal widths? Thought I had done that. Okay, anyway, so this looks pretty good for our UI, okay, using the space, et cetera. It's kind of lining things up nicely. So let's go ahead and create a couple of outlets to plug into these two things. All right, let's make sure we set the right class for this. We don't want it to be a GPX waypoint controller. We want it to be an edit waypoint view controller. Right? That's why we weren't getting the right class here when we tried to do our outlets. All right, let's drag this outlet in here. And this outlet is going to be the name text field. And this one is going to be, we'll call this the info text field. All right, so we've kind of set up our UI here, how we want it. what do we want to do here in terms of a, let's make this go over here. Let's look at our edit wave. Okay, what do we want to do in terms of a public model here so that people can set it? Well, that's obvious. We want the waypoint to edit. Okay, a GPX, sorry, editable waypoint. Let it be optional. So that's the public API. If someone sets this waypoint, then obviously we're going to have our UI show it. And when the UI is changing, it's going to be changing this waypoint. So when it gets set, we're going to have to update our UI. So we'll call update UI and make a method that does that. Probably here when these, well, we'll talk about that in a second. So let's get our private func update UI. So what do we do to update the UI? I'm just going to have the name text fields text equal the waypoint to edit name. And similarly, the info text field text equals the waypoint to edit info. Okay, so that's updating that. Probably also we should view did load. And if you did load, we'll also update our UI. That way, when we're segueing to it or something, if we set this before our outlets are set, later on, our outlets will set and we'll update them. Now, this is great for transferring information from the waypoint to our text fields. What about the other way? We edit in the text fields, we have to edit our waypoint. So how are we going to do that? Well, there's actually a number of ways to do that. I already showed you in text field how to do that with delegate methods. I'm going to show you how to do it now with radio stations. Okay, text fields actually broadcast on a radio station, and one of the things they'll broadcast is, my text changed. So you can listen to that radio station, and every time the text changes, you can update whatever thing you want to update. Now, before we do that, we also need some things from the text fields delegate, however, like I'd like to control the keyboard a little bit. So every time you press return in the keyboard, I'd like to remove the keyboard. Just to clear it out of your way. So how am I going to do that? I'm going to make sure that I am the name text fields delegate. Okay, so let's go ahead and make sure we are a UI text field delegate. We'll do the same thing with the info text field here. All right, so now we're the delegate. What are we going to do here on that famous text field should return delegate method right here? I'm just going to say text field resign your first responder. Okay, and then I'll return true because it can do whatever it wants there. We're not going to have any action set up, so it's not going to matter anyway. And in fact, another thing I'd like is when this MVC first appears, I'd like the keyboard to appear. Okay, I want it to come up. Don't want to have to make the person touch in there. So I'm going to say let's do the name text field become first responder. Okay, so that means when we did load, we're going to become the first responder. Yeah, question.
Sorry, did you say text field should return?
Oh, good catch. Okay, so this is not supposed to be text field should clear. This is text field should return. Okay, good catch. That's why you guys are here, to catch these mistakes. So there we go. Text field should return. All right, so that's going to manage our keyboard. But now what about those radio stations? So let's go ahead and when our view appears on screen, okay, when we get view did appear, we're going to start listening to those radio stations. And when we get view will disappear, then we'll stop listening. All right, so view will appear, or let's even do view did appear. Super view did appear. That escape completion is taking some getting used to for me, obviously, and I made it. All right, so we got a view did appear, and so I'm just going to say listen in here, listen to text fields. Okay, and we'll make a little private func that does that. Okay, so how are we going to listen to the text fields? Let's go ahead and get ourselves the center, okay, the NS notification. Notification center.default center. And let's get the queue that we want. We're going to do all this on the main queue. So ns operation queue.main queue. All right, now that we have those two little variables here, I'm going to ask the center to listen to this radio station. So I'm going to add observer for name. Okay, hit return here so you can see this again, just as we did last time. All right, what's the name of the radio station? It's UI Text Field Text Did Change. You can see it's got a couple of other radio stations there too for begin end editing, but I'm going to get the one where every time the text changes, every single character, it's going to update. The object here, okay, this one I'm going to be listening to the name text field, okay, and we'll do it on the main queue. And here's the block. So what's our block going to do here? We actually don't even need to look at the notification because we know this is the name text field right here that's changed. So I'm just going to say here, if I can let waypoint equal our waypoint to edit, so if our waypoint to edit is not nil, basically, then let's go ahead and have the waypoint's name equal the name text field's text, right? So every time this name text field changes, we're going to update our name, okay? And this needs to be self because we're inside of a closure here. Okay, and we'll do exact same thing for the info text field. One thing we could have done, by the way, is had the object we're listening to be nil and get all UI text field things and then look at the text field that's sending it to us and figure out which one it is. But, you know, what if we had other text fields, other places in our UI that were listening and maybe they weren't good and that they kept listening even when they were off screen and all that? We started getting all these. This is, you know, a little bit more code in terms of the lines of code I have to write right here, but it makes these closures really, really, really simple. Okay, so this is going to be the info text field update. Now, the in view did appear here. We're listening to the text fields. In view will disappear, we need to stop listening to these. Okay, so how do we do that? Okay, we just ask the notification center, default center, to remove the observer, okay, that is this guy right here. And same thing, we'll have to do another one for this. So this is where we have to use the return value of this add observer for name. It actually returns something. We'll call this one NTF observer. And this is just basically a cookie that represents this radio station going here. So we'll need a couple of private vars here, NTF observer. These things are of type NS object protocol, which basically just means they're Objective-C compatible things. Visible to the Objective-C runtime, okay? And so we'll have info text field observer also. Okay, so we'll let the NTF observer equal that. We'll have the ITF observer equal this. Okay, now that we have these cookies, when we want to remove them here, okay, we can just put them in here. But we want to make sure they're not nil, so I'm going to say if I can let observer equal the NTF observer, then I will remove that observer. And same thing down here, if I can let observer equal the ITF observer, then I will move that. Probably could have made a nice little function that did this so that I don't have this kind of same repeated code style here. Also, actually, probably want to put these in another private func, maybe call it private func stop listening to text fields. That in there, and we'll call that from here. Okay, arrange this a little bit better, put this down here. Okay, so we're basically listening and stop listening. So everyone understand that? See how we're using radio stations to find out what's happening in the text field? So it's kind of a fun way to do that. All right, so the last thing we need to do here is our prepare for segue. Right over here, when we do this other segue, this modal segue, we need to prepare for it. So let's do that. Say else if segue.identifier equals edit user waypoint. Okay, that's the name of that identifier. Then in here, we just want to get that editable waypoint. So I'm going to say if I can let the editable waypoint equal the waypoint as an editable waypoint, so make sure it's editable. It always should be, we wouldn't be here. Let's put a comma here. Then we can let our editable waypoint view controller equal the destination as, yes, edit waypoint view controller. Okay, then we just set the EWVC's waypoint to edit, which is its public model there, to the editable waypoint. Okay, Now, let's go back to our storyboard here and take a look at how we're going to create the segue right here, because right now there's no segue. This thing is free as a bird out here flying around, okay? So we want to edit it, so we're going to do the same thing we did here when we created this one, which is to drag from the view controller, whoops, not that one, from this view controller right here. We're going to drag from this guy up to our new MVC, so let's do that, controlling drag up here. Now this time though, we're going to do something new. This one's going to be presented modally. So instead of saying show and having it appear inside this navigation controller, we're going to do present modally, and it's going to take over the whole screen while we're editing the waypoint. So we do present modally. Now let's go ahead and take a look at this. Sorry, let's make this a little easier to see here. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at this segue that was just created in the inspector. Okay, so you obviously will need an identifier. I think I called this one edit waypoint. Hope that's what I called it. Let's go take a quick look. Make sure we get it right in our constants. Yes, edit waypoint, that's what we call this segue right there. You can see it's got present modally here. Okay, and we'll take a look at this presentation styles down here a little bit later. Okay, but for right now we just want to present modally. So let's go ahead and see what this does. All right, so here we go. We're going to drop an editable waypoint. Okay, it says dropped. We can pick it up and move it. Okay, to anywhere we want, like to that airport again. And hopefully if we press this I, we're going to get this modal segue to this new MVC. So we hit the I, there we go, modal segue. Now, we got some problems here. Looks like we got a little problem with our auto layout there. We'll have to take a look at that. And in fact, we better fix that or we're not going to be able to edit this. So let's go back to our storyboard here and take a look at what the problem. Probably was that thing where I said same width. Somebody has the same width who shouldn't, I believe. Maybe one of these stack views. Let's take a look at this guy. So I'm just going to, when you get a problem with your auto layout, it's kind of a good idea to make a little tour through your various things. Like you can even see I've got red here, conflicting constraints, so we know there's problems. And sure enough, look at this. When I said try to make the description equal to the name, I made this whole stack view equal to the name. See that? Equal width to name. This whole stack view, so that's not good. So I didn't want this, so I'm just going to delete that constraint. And now this has probably fixed the problem because you see I have no more warning of conflicting constraint. Okay, so let's go try again, see if that makes our UI look a little better. All right, we'll drop here. Edit. That looks a lot better, okay? And you can see that it passed from the prepare for segue, it passed our existing name and info, which is just dropped with no info, into here. And it also put the keyboard up, was nice. And if I get rid of, hit return, it makes the keyboard go away. And if I make one of these first responder, it comes back, right? And I can edit this. Let's say I'll say, I love it when people do something, okay? And how about the fact is your name. Okay, so here's our basically name of our waypoint and the description. And so, how do we get out of here? It's like, we can't get out. So this is the problem I was telling you about modal. You have to provide a way for your user to escape once they've edited whatever they want to edit. Okay, so how are we going to do that? Let's go back to our storyboard. Simple way to do it is to put this inside a navigation controller and put a done button up there, like we saw in the slides. So let's do that. Let's go here, edit, embed in navigation controller. It puts it in a navigation controller right here. And we're just gonna put a done button right there. So let's go down here, search for bar button item. Here it is, a bar button item. We'll put it right up here. I think there's even a standard system one for that. Maybe, yeah, there's a done button right there. Okay, for clicking done. And then we'll just make this done button call a method in this view controller. By the way, so you can see our stack view frames are a little off now. We can fix that by clicking on here and doing update frames. Moves that down. But let's make this so that it sends a message to ourselves and we'll dismiss ourselves. Okay, so let's do that. We get here. We'll put this, let's make it a little more space for you there. Okay, we'll put that dismiss, how about, right up after our view controller life cycle here. Okay, so I'm just gonna control drag right in here. This is gonna be an action. This is my done action, I'll call it. Okay, bar button item is gonna be the argument. Here it is. Now, remember, again, let's go to full width here. Remember here, we don't want to say just dismiss view controller animated. We want to get our presenting view controller, that's the view controller that presented us, and ask it to dismiss us. Okay? And we don't care when that happens. Okay, so don't forget that. I'm kind of putting this self here just to let you know I'm talking about myself's presenting view controller, but you don't need self there, obviously. Okay? Understand that? All right, so let's see that. See how that makes this work. All right, so we'll drop this. Go here, we'll edit it. Comes up, we've got our navigation controller. It's edit. We probably should have put a title called edit waypoint or something like that. So let's go ahead and edit this again. So let's say the best thing. Okay, that's what our name is. And the description is the only way. All right, so we got the best thing and the only way there. And we hit done, and it still says dropped. Okay, now why is that? Well, that's because that call out was put up, and when it's put up, it's loaded up with the waypoints information, and it stays that way all the time. Okay, the only time it changes is if it goes away and comes back. When it comes back, it came back. Okay, now we got a bug somewhere in our code because it should have our subtitle there, but that was really annoying for our user that they went and edited this, and when they came back, it still said dropped. Okay, so let's fix the bug so that this the only way, which I think was the info, was, yes, so here we go. This should be info equals info text field. Okay, so how are we going to fix that? Well, one thing about it right off the bat is that when we click on this little I, I'm going to take this call out off the screen, because I know it's pretty much invalid right away. Because if I go over here and change this to anything else, that thing's no good anymore. So let's do that as step one. Let's just take that call out away when we do this perform segue. So let's find where we do that perform segue. It's in this funny little call out accessory tapped, right? Here's where we perform that segue. And when we perform that segue, we're going to remove that call out when we do that. And so we do that by saying map view deselect annotation, because the reason that call out is up is because this annotation is selected. So if we deselect this annotation, it will remove that call out. And what do we want to do? We want to remove the annotation in the view that our call out is currently accessory control tapping. And sure, we'll animate it, although it probably doesn't matter that it's animated because we're going to put a modal thing right on top of it, but maybe it'll be fading out as that's sliding in. That might be kind of nice. Okay, so let's see if that fixes our problem. All right, here we go. Put this on the airport here. We'll click there. There's dropped. We click. Okay, we go to dropped. Yeah, we'll put something in here. See, I'm so excited. Good. Description, the fact is. Okay, and we'll hit done, and hopefully, oh, it's not showing it. So at least it's not saying dropped, so that's an improvement, right? But if we click on it, it's showing it. So really what we'd like is, when we come back from that modal segue, we'd like it to put this thing back up with the new information. Okay, so how are we gonna do that? Because we don't know when that modal thing goes away, okay? It's just getting dismissed, right? So this is a good opportunity to show you unwind. Okay, so we're gonna, instead of hitting done and having it dismiss ourselves, we're going to do an unwind segue back to our GPX controller. And when it gets that message, that special message, it'll know, oh, I'm gonna put this thing back up. Okay, so let's do that. So how do we do that? We know that when we unwind, we always want to create one of these special methods, okay? And those special methods, first of all, they're always IB actions, okay? They can have any name that we want, so we'll call ours updated user waypoint, because that's what happened, okay? When the unwind happens, the user update waypoint got updated. And the other thing that's special about it, the argument has to be a UI storyboard segue. Okay, so this is the special mesh. And this is all we need to do to create one of these special methods. We'll call it a func. All right, and so now anybody can unwind to this as long as there's something we presented. Any MVC that we've presented or that was presented by somebody we presented, et cetera, can now unwind back to us here. Now, what are we going to do when we unbind back to here? Well, we're going to reselect that annotation that we deselected when we left. So let's do that. I'll create a little function to do that called select waypoint. Okay, and select waypoint. We got to get the waypoint we selected. It's a little tricky. Watch this. I'm going to get the segues source view controller. That's the view controller that is sending us this unwind. So that's going to be the modal segue, right? That's the source of the unwind. So we're going to get that source view controller, and actually we'll get its content view controller, okay? And it has to be an edit waypoint view controller. And if we're able to find that, then we'll just get its waypoint to edit, okay? That's obviously the waypoint that we want to select. So we need this method select waypoint. Let's do that. Func select waypoint takes a waypoint, which is a GPX waypoint. We'll even make it optional if we want to pass it in there. And we'll just say if the waypoint does not equal nil, then we are going to go to the map view and tell it to select an annotation, which is the waypoint. Okay, remember that all of our waypoints are annotations, so we can directly ask the map view. This is what's really nice about having some data structure that we already have in our app, like a GPX waypoint, implement that MK annotation protocol, because we're not having to constantly create these other little things that contain all the waypoint, the MK annotation information. We can just get it directly from our waypoints. Okay, so this is going to select it. So now we have to unwind to this instead of doing done. So let's go back to our storyboard here. Okay, we've got this done. I'm going to disconnect done from this done method, right? So I'm just going here and disconnecting it. So now it's not going to send done. And in fact, if we go back to our edit waypoint view controller, we can just delete this done method entirely, wherever it is. Oh, there it is. Okay, we're not even going to use that anymore. Instead of doing that, we are going to unwind. So let's go back here and unwind. So how do we unwind? Everyone remember? Control drag to this exit button. Okay, this is how you unwind. This is saying, I want this done button to unwind, okay, to exit this MVC and go back to one of its presenters. And look, when we click, look what we see in the list, updated user waypoint, that method we put there with the special IB action and the segue as an argument, okay? And every method in every MVC we ever would have put in our entire app that was like that would appear here. Yeah, question.
Does the unwind only work in a navigation view controller?
So the question, does unwind only work inside a navigation controller? And the answer is no, it works anywhere. So you could have just a non-navigation controller MVC, present another one modally, which presents another one modally, and then you unwind back to either of those two. So it has nothing to do with navigation controller. This is not pop, back or anything. This is really just take these MVCs off until you get back to the guy who implements this method. Okay. Now, it would work in a navigation controller as well. It would pop back from that as well, but it works in any environment, basically. All right, so I'm going to click that, and that's going to make the done button unwind to that method. Okay, and so that method is going to get called. So let's be looking at this method when it happens. Let's go over here. All right, so drop the pin right here. We're going to click, show it says dropped right here. We're going to go edit it, change it to something here. How about the fact that you have to? And we'll call this I'm so happy. Okay, so we're going to hit done here, and hopefully we're going to see that call out show up without having to click on anything. And sure enough, it does. Okay, because it unwind back, called this code right here, which selected that annotation. This is back in our GPX view controller here, see? Okay, everybody got the unwind there? All right, the next segue we're gonna look at is popovers. Okay, let's take a look at our app on iPad. And to do this, I'm actually gonna do it on the device over here. So let's go up here this device and run this. We made this a universal app, so it should work fine over here. But sure enough, there it is, zooming into where we are. Okay, here's our stuff. We can zoom in here, and we can click on these things just like we could before, and we can segue to see this. Okay, all that stuff is nice. And we can also add new pins. So I'm just long pressing. There's a pin. Okay, let's click there. Okay, dropped. I'm going to edit it. Whoa. Okay, now this is pretty ugly UI. Okay, do not do this in your final project. I cannot tell you how many final projects think, oh, I've made it work on the iPad with this kind of UI. Okay, this kind of UI, it looks ridiculous. You're never going to have the name and description be that long. Okay, so you don't want that. There are other ways of presenting modal MVCs that look a lot better on iPad. So let's go pick one of them. Let's go back to our storyboard here. Let's go back to our storyboard. And we're just going to change our segue here. This is the modal segue, okay, that puts this thing up. Okay, we're going to inspect it. And we're going to try a different presentation, like, for example, form sheet. So form sheet is much more appropriate for the iPad. So let's go ahead and run this, see what form sheet looks like, the form sheet modal presentation. It's just a different presentation than take over the whole screen. It still takes over the whole screen, it just does it a little more space efficiently here. All right, so I'm dropping a pin there, and we're going to edit it, and you can see that this gives a much more sensible looking space. Now, the background here on the side, the gray on the side, okay, is not active. I can't do anything with it, so it's still modal. It's still completely taking over. It's just presenting it a little nicer here, okay? And I can still do all the things that I would do here, you know, hello, okay? So that's nice, but really, on the iPad, what would be really cool is to do it in a little popover right there, okay? To have the name and info just be in a small little popover pointing right at that little pin, that would be a much better UI. And so it's great because now we can learn how to do popovers. So let's do that. How are we going to do popovers? When we have a popover, we're not going to want this navigation controller in here. Okay? We'll zoom out so you can see it. Okay, when we have a popover to do this, we want to get rid of this navigation controller here. So I'm going to delete that. So we have this. Okay? Now I'm just going to create a popover in the same way as we created all the other ones, okay, which is control drag from here up to here. But this time I'm going to choose present as popover. Okay? And this creates this right here. You can see here's the popover segue. Now, we of course need an identifier for it. We're going to do the same identifier because we're going to have the same prepare segue as we had for the modal one, which was edit waypoint. Right? Notice popover has some little extra things down here. Okay? And this mostly has to do with when I put this popover up, okay, where do you want it to appear? And part of where it wants to appear is where you're going to allow the popover's little arrow to point up or left or down or right. That's going to kind of position it a little bit. In our case, we'll let it point any direction. So depending on whether your waypoint is up in the left corner or in the right corner, we'll let the popover be above it, below it, whatever the system thinks is best. But the popover also needs an anchor, which is when I come up, I got to point at something. And we're not bringing this up with a bar button or something we can point to. We're bringing it up by clicking on this little annotation thing. So we really want the anchor to be those pins, okay? So those pins are in the map view. So I'm going to have the anchor right here be the map view. And then in code, I'm going to specify a rectangle in the map view, which contains that little annotation view. So the way I make the map view be the anchor is I control drag over to this, okay, from the little circle, like that. And you can see it puts the map view in there. So now it's saying, okay, I understand that I'm going to point up pointing to somewhere in the map view. In your code, you better tell me where. And we're going to tell it where. Okay? Good. Okay. All right. So where are we going to set that little rectangle? Okay? We're going to set that in our prepare for segue, for this segue. That's where you set up all your popover stuff, is in the prepare for segue, for that segue. So here is that part of this prepare for segue, right? The edit user waypoint part of the prepare for segue. All we're going to do here is get the popover presentation controller. So if we can get that, we get it from the MVC we're presenting. So in this case, it's the EWVC, the Edit Waypoint View Controller. We get it from that. And we get it from this method, popover presentation controller. Okay, now if we're not popping over, this will be nil, this code won't execute. Excellent, okay, but if we're doing a popover, then it will not be nil. So in here, we configure the popover presentation controller, and you can go look at the doc, but one of the things you can do is the source rectangle that it's going to point to in your anchor view. Okay, and what is this going to be? Well, that's easy for us. That's just going to be the annotation view's frame. Okay, the frame of the little pin. That's where we want the popover to point. Make sense? All right, so let's run this, see what it looks like. All right, so we'll drop this here, click on it, and whoa! Well, okay, we're making progress, but I don't think we're quite there. So what's wrong with this? Well, one thing is, that thing is huge, way bigger than it needs to be. Why is it so big? The answer is because no one told it what size it was supposed to be, okay? And you remember from the slides, we do this in an object-oriented way. The system wants the MVC that's being put up to say, what size do you want to be? Now, what's really cool is I'm going to calculate that size using auto layout, okay? I'm basically going to say, make yourself as small as you can and still obey the auto layout rules, okay? And you can do that with one line of code. It's really cool. All right, so where am I going to do that? So I'm going to do that in my edit waypoint view controller, okay? This is the view controller that's coming up there, so it's the one responsible for setting its preferred size. And I'm going to do it in the view controller lifecycle method, view will layout subviews, okay? So I know that in view will layout subviews, my bounds is going to be set to whatever the latest thing is, so I know I'm going to have some good bounds situation. So I'm just going to, in here, I'm going to set my preferred content size, that's the size that I prefer to be the following thing, view dot, okay, and all views implement this cool method, system layout size, fitting size. Okay, so that's basically saying, use auto layout and tell me what size will fit in this size the best. And there's a really cool size, predefined size, called the UI layout fitting size. There's a expanded size, which means make me as big as you can and obey auto layout. And then there's compressed size, which is make me as small as you can. Okay, so I'm going to go for compressed size. Okay, and it's going to give me a size that fits as small as possible using auto layout. Okay, so this is a really cool little method. It's how you get auto layout to calculate a size for you. All right? So let's see. Now that the size is right, let's go see if that's going to fix things. I don't think it's going to be quite right, but it's going to be close. All right, here we go. Drop a pin. We're going to click on it. Oops. I clicked on the side of it, okay, and edit it. Okay, now this is really close, okay? It's really nice. See how it's making just the right size. The problem is the text editing part is pretty small because look what it did. It sized it to the word dropped, okay? And why did it do that? Because in our auto layout, we didn't tell it anything else about what size it should be. So it put the contents in there and it made it as small as possible and fit the contents. So we actually want to go back to our storyboard and put a minimum, reasonable minimum size for those text fields so that they will give the person room to type something in, okay? The other thing is the background is white. This may be hard for you to see on that screen, but if you look where the little arrow is pointing next to the word description there, that's actually semi-transparent, and then all of a sudden where the name and description is a white box. Okay, so it's actually possible to have the whole thing be this semi-transparent so that we can kind of see that we're on top of a map. It won't feel so kind of obnoxious, this white box. And the way to do that is just to make this MVC have a background of clear. Okay, then it's just going to appear clear on top of the popover's background, which is semi-transparent. Okay, so we're going to fix both of those things at once. So we're going to go back to our storyboard here. Okay, we're going to make it so that these text fields right here, okay, are a reasonable minimum size. So what would be a reasonable minimum size? Let's go here to our width here and height. And so I could say a width of maybe, 250 points. This is something you could play with in your UI. I really only need to set one of these because these are already going to be the same width. And so that's going to force these to be the same width. But actually, I don't want it to be exactly 250. I want it to be at least 250. Okay? Because if the name is really long and it'll fit without going off the edge of the screen, sure, you can do it. So I add the constraint here to be 250, and you can see that it makes it exactly 250, but I don't want that. So I'm going to go over here to my dimensions inspector and look at this width 250. I'm going to edit it and change it to greater than or equal to 250. Okay? So understand that auto layout is pretty configurable. You don't have to make things always be exactly certain sizes. Okay? So we'll go ahead and adjust our frames here. Okay. Got that? Okay, now what about the clear? That's really simple. I'm just going to click the background view here, and instead of having it be white, okay, this background view, I'm going to have it be the default, which is clear. Okay, so let's run again. Okay, yes, so now it's working. All right, so let's drop a pin. Okay, we're going to edit it. Here we go. Boom. Perfect. Okay, give us a little extra space to work with. We can see, can you see that? Yeah, you can see it's kind of a little bit see-through. You can see it's a little bit green behind that. It looks a lot nicer. Okay, so excellent. Wow, popovers are great. I'm sure this didn't do any damage on the iPhone side. Let's go take a look. Okay. iPhone. I'm sure the iPhone looks just great. All right, here it is. Drop a pin. All right, there it is. Yep, here we go. Ooh, ugh. Okay, well, clearly we totally broke, understandably, broke our iPhone side of this. So what's wrong here? What's going on? Well, first of all, we took it out of the navigation controller, so we lost our done button. Okay. So we're done, okay? Second one is we made the background clear, so it's looking into the void because we know that when it adapts, okay? First of all, why is it coming up this way? Well, the system knows this is horizontally compact, so it adapted from popover to full screen modal, okay? Full screen modal completely covers the thing underneath it, doesn't show through, it completely covers it. And it covers it with the void, the great void, okay? And since we're looking clear into the void, it's black, okay? The void happens to be black. All right, so that's why this looks so terrible. So what are we going to do about this, okay? There's a number of things that we can do to make this a lot better. Actually, before we do this, let's do one other quick thing. I'm going to show you one other quick thing. Let's go back over to our look at our iPad here, okay? We back on the iPad there. Okay, so when I change this, let's say I change something here, let's change it to I'm not going, okay? I'm not going, and I hit return. And now, how do we dismiss a popover? We just hit somewhere else, right? So here we go, tap. Oh, look at that. It didn't show it to us. Remember when we had it on the iPhone, when I clicked done, it showed it. Now it's not showing. Now if I click on it, okay, it worked, that's great, but no, we want it to show, just like it did on the iPhone. So how are we going to fix that? That's pretty easy to fix. We're going to use, over here in our GPX controller, this same popover presentation controller. We're going to implement one of its delegate methods. Okay, so we're going to set ourselves as the delegate of this popover presentation controller, which means, of course, we have to go up here and say that we are a UI popover presentation controller delegate. Okay, remember that. All right, so we're a popover presentation controller delegate. Which popover presentation controller delegate method are we going to implement here? We're going to implement the one where we find out that it dismissed. Dismiss popover. Okay, so this message gets sent to the popover presentation controller's delegate when the popover is dismissed. A perfect time for us to reselect that waypoint. Okay, we have that method still, select waypoint, so let's go ahead and do it. How do we get it this time? Well, we're going to get this from the popover presentation controller. Okay, we're going to get its presented view controller. Okay, that's the controller it's presenting, which is our editable view, waypoint view controller. And it better be an edit waypoint view controller. Okay, and if it is, then we can just get the waypoint to edit. Okay, so now when we run this, okay, so we'll drop, click, go up here, change this to something, random words. The only thing is, tip away, and we got it. Okay, so that's a great use of that little delegate. But there are even better uses of that little delegate, and a lot of them have to do with this adaptation behavior, okay? The way that the system is adapting to that horizontally compact environment and putting that thing up on our iPhone in this really obnoxious way, okay? So let's go and fix some of these things. One thing we could do to fix this is we could make it not adapt. Okay? We can make it just so that it uses popover on iPhone. It doesn't do this whole putting a modal one up instead. Okay? So how would we do that? All right, that one. We're going to implement a different delegate method here, popover delegate. This one is called, if I can remember here, the, I have a note here, adaptive presentation style for presentation controller. Okay, this guy right here. Okay, adaptive presentation style for presentation controller. Actually, we want a different one. We want the one that gives us the trait collection. Adaptive presentation style. It's this one. Okay, so this one is basically asking us, make it so you can see it a little better here. Okay, it has two arguments here, and it returns a modal presentation style. So this is saying, for a given trait collection, like horizontally compact or whatever, how do you want to present this thing in, when you're adapting? Now, if I don't implement this, what it does is it looks at this trait collection, says, is it horizontally compact? Yes, then return full screen. That's how this whole adaptation thing works. Well, I can fix that by just saying return none. Okay, that means don't adapt. Okay, so now it will never adapt. Now, if I run on the iPhone, you'll see that it's not going to adapt because I set the presentation style, the adapting style to be none. So it's never going to adapt. Go here, we click this, sure enough, we get that. Now, look how terrible this looks. Okay, clearly horizontally compact is not wide enough to show this popover. Okay, it smashed it in there, tried to obey the 250 points wide for the text field. The name and description got cut off. It just not, you know, couldn't quite point to the the pin problem is a big mess. So this is not the solution to this problem. Seems like it would be a good solution to this problem, but it's not. So let's go try and solve some of those other problems we had. Okay, one is we had no done button. Okay, so how can we get the done button back? Well, we need to put that thing back into navigation controller, but only when we're adapting. Okay, so first of all, I'm going to comment this out so that we're back to adapting. And I'm going to implement another delegate method here, which is called view controller for adaptive presentation style. Here it is. Okay, again, I'll show you the arguments here. Okay, now look what this one returns. This one returns a view controller. This is basically saying, okay, I'm trying to adapt to a certain style. That's going to be the full screen style here. Give me a view controller to show when I adapt. Okay, now if I don't implement this, it's just going to use the edit waypoint view controller. Okay, but I'm going to fix this to return a navigation controller that has the edit waypoint controller in it. Okay, so let's do that. I'm going to say, first I'm going to let, first I'm going to say if the style that we're adapting to is full screen, okay, then I'm going to create a navigation controller, let navcon equal a UI navigation. I'm just creating it with its constructor, right, its initializer. And the root view controller of it is going to be the controller's presented view controller. Remember, we use that in the other one. Okay, that is the edit waypoint view controller that we're trying to present. That's what it is. And so now I'm just going to return this navigation controller instead. So it's going to use the navigation controller instead of this. If we're not adapting to full screen, then I'm going to return nil and let it do whatever it does by default, which is, you know, use the popover or it's not adapting, so it doesn't matter. All right, let's see if that fixes anything here. All right, here we go. Drop it, click on it, boom. Woohoo! Look at that, we have a done button back. Now, that done button, by the way, you might say, where'd that come from? Okay, well, that's because we put the done button into that MVC back when it used to be in a navigation controller. When we removed the navigation controller, it kept the done button. It wasn't able to display it because it wasn't in a navigation controller until now, again, but it kept the done button. Remember that all the things that appear in a navigation controller's title bar, the buttons and stuff, are associated with the MVC inside. Okay, and when you remove, put something in, embed in, or take out of a navigation controller, an MVC, it keeps all its things. So that's why we kept the done button. Okay, not only keep the done button there, it's still gonna unwind. Okay, because it's still hooked up to the to unwind there. Now we still have this black background. That's not so good. Okay, how are we gonna fix that? Well, I'm gonna do that in a cool way, which is to stop having it basically cover up the thing underneath and let it show through. Okay, I'm gonna have this modal view controller come up, but not cover up what's behind. Okay, and that's really simple to do. Actually, we're gonna use the same method we did back here. Okay, but instead of saying return none, okay, we're just gonna say, let's just return, if the trait collection here, trait collection, horizontal size class equals compact, then we're going to return this new style, which is over full screen. So over full screen is like full screen, but it's over the thing, so the thing shines through. Okay, that's the only difference between full screen and over full screen. Otherwise, we're just going to not adapt. Okay, we're only going to adapt in the horizontal size class compact. Okay, so let's see what that looks like. All right, here it is. Drop one, click, bring it up. All right, okay, it brought it up. But it's kind of weird that we can see all the way through. It kind of makes it think that we could click on these things. Also, having the word description be on the dark background makes it hard to see it, okay? I also noticed that maybe our 250 is a little too wide of a minimum. Maybe we want to go down to 200. But what would be really cool is if we could actually show what's behind slightly blurred, just like the popover one does, right? The popover one, it showed the name and description, but it was on a kind of a slightly see-through, semi-transparent, blurred thing. Well, we can do that ourselves, okay? There's a view, okay, we didn't talk about it in the slides, but there's a view which essentially presents whatever's behind it blurred, okay? That's what the view does. So we're going to put one of those views right at the top of the navigation controller's view hierarchy. Okay, even behind things like this bar at the top for the navigation control, everything. Okay, we're going to put it really right at the top, so it's going to blur everything behind, and the navigation controller is going to be on top of this nice blurred thing. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, we create that navigation controller right here. So all we need to do is create this little blurring view doohickey, which is called a visual effects view. And also, by the way, we're going to want to put here if the style is over full screen, so that we do it in both cases there. So we're going to create a visual effects view, we'll call it. And it's UI visual effects view, that's the name of the class. Visual effect view. I guess it would be visual effect view because it's a single effect. And you just specify what kind of effect you want. Effect, and I want a UI blur effect. And the style of it is I want extra light, okay, which is a really extra light blur. And the reason I want extra light is because I'm going to be putting black text on top of it and things like that, so I really want that to stand out. So I want this extra light blurring. Now I'm going to set the visual effects views frame to equal the navcon's bounds. Okay, so navcon is a view controller. It's just a regular view controller like any other view controller. It's got a view, which is its top level view. So I'm going to put my visual effects right at the top of its hierarchy, so I'm going to have it fill the entire thing. Now I'm also going to do a little bit of magic here, which we didn't talk about at all, which is there's a really kind of an old style way of doing auto layout where you can specify just a couple of things. And I'm going to have this visual effect view always stick to the same size as the NavCon's bounds. And the way I'm going to do it is by using these old style constraints where I basically say that the width and height of my visual effects view is flexible. So as things change, it tries to stick to its super view. Okay, don't worry too much about this magic. It's just a little easier way than doing this than trying to show you how to do it with the new way. So I just basically say that its auto resizing mass is flexible width and flexible height. If its super view changes its size, then it sizes with it using the rules, keep your width and height flexible. Okay, so now I'm just going to take that NavCon top level view and insert a sub view, which is the visual effects view. And I'm going to put it at index 0, which is all the way at the back. Remember, the subviews is ordered in the subview list. All right, so let's take a look at that. All right, drop it here, up. There we go. Okay, see how it, you can kind of see the, I don't know how good the projection there is, but you can kind of almost see the valleys here, the mountains and the valleys. In there. When you get this and go run it at home, you'll see it a lot clearer, probably. Okay? So that's it. We only have 3 minutes left, so I'm not going to do the slides on that. I will post on Piazza how you can learn a little bit more about that. And that's it. So that's everything there. You learned a lot about map view and of all kinds of segues there. So hopefully that'll prepare you for your final presentation. So next week is just the alternate final. There's a holiday on Monday, so there's no class then. And Wednesday is the alternate final. And if you have any questions, I'll be here as usual.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.